Hello everyone and welcome to this press conference on the Bank of England's Financial Stability Report. On the line we have John Cunliffe, Deputy Governor for Financial Stability, Sam Woods, Deputy Governor for Prudential Regulation, and the Governor, Andrew Bailey. We'll turn to questions shortly, but Andrew will now deliver a few opening remarks to get us going.
Well, thanks Seb, and welcome to the presentation of the bank's July financial stability report. So the UK financial system has provided support to households and businesses to weather the economic disruption from the COVID pandemic. This has been the first big test of the post-financial crisis reforms, notably to the resilience of banks. And so far, the results have been encouraging. In recent months, the rapid rollout of the UK's vaccination programme has led to an improvement in the UK economic outlook. But the risks to that recovery remain. And households and businesses will need continuing support from the financial system as the economy continues to recover. The UK banking system has the capacity to continue to provide the support that households and businesses need. Major UK banks have built inside its capital and liquidity positions have remained strong. The FPC reaffirms its judgment that the banking sector remains resilient to severely adverse paths of the economy, supported by the interim results of this year's solvency stress test. The FPC expects banks to use all elements of capital buffers as necessary to support the economy through the recovery. Now, to support this, the FPC expects to maintain the UK countercyclical capital buffer rate at 0% until at least December of this year. To inform its decision around when to increase the CCYB, the committee will monitor a range of factors, including the evolution of the economic recovery, prevailing financial conditions, and the outlook for banks' capital. The FPC supports the PRC's decision that extraordinary guardrails on shareholder distributions are no longer necessary, consistent with the return to the PRA's standard approach to capital setting and shareholder distributions this year. The FPC also judges that the interim results of this year's solvency stress test, together with the central outlook, are consistent with the PRC's decision. As the economy recovers, the FPC will remain vigilant to risks and debt vulnerabilities. Through the pandemic, UK corporate debt levels have increased modestly, although the increase in indebtedness has been more substantial in some sectors and among some small and medium-sized firms. Support from the financial system and the government has helped keep business insolvencies relatively low. However, companies with weaker balance sheets, particularly in sectors most affected by the restrictions on economic activity and SMEs, will be more vulnerable to increases in financing costs. The share of households with high debt servicing burdens has increased slightly during the course of the pandemic, but remains significantly below its level prior to the global financial crisis. House price growth and housing market activity in the first half of this year have been at their highest levels in over a decade, reflecting a mix of temporary policy support and structural factors. However, there has only been a small increase in mortgage borrowing relative to income in aggregates, and debt servicing ratios remain low. The FPC's mortgage market measures are in place and aim to limit any rapid build-up in aggregate indebtedness and in the share of highly indebted households. The FPC is continuing its review of the calibration of its mortgage market measures. Risky asset prices have continued to increase, and in some markets, asset valuations appear elevated relative to historical norms. This partly reflects the improved economic outlook, but may also reflect a search for yield in a low interest rate environment and higher risk taking. The proportion of corporate bonds issued that are high yield is currently at its highest level in the past decade. And there is evidence of loosening underwriting standards, especially in leveraged loan markets. This could increase potential losses in a future stress, and highly leveraged firms have also been shown to amplify downturns in the real economy. Asset valuations could correct sharply if, for example, market participants reevaluate the prospects for growth or inflation and therefore interest rates. Any such correction could be amplified by vulnerabilities in market-based finance. The FPC remains focused on building a stronger and safer system for the future. On that, first, the FPC is fully engaged in and supportive of the international work to tackle the vulnerabilities in market-based finance exposed during the Dash for Cash in March of last year. It is important that market-based finance is resilient to and does not amplify shocks. The FPC has previously identified a number of vulnerabilities in the sector and supports the recent progress to address these. As part of this, the FPC has published today its response to a request from Her Majesty's Treasury to assess the oversight and mitigation of risks to financial stability from the non-bank financial sector. The FPC has also fully endorsed the proposals from the Joint Bank and FCA Review on Liquidity Risk Management and Swing Pricing in Open-Ended Funds, and views them as an important contribution to the international work currently in train to reduce financial stability risks arising from liquidity mismatches in open-ended funds. As the FPC has noted previously, the mismatch between redemption terms and the liquidity of some funds' assets means there is an incentive for investors to redeem ahead of others, particularly in a stress. This first mover advantage has the potential to become a systemic risk by creating run dynamics and thus disrupting the supply of credit to the economy. Further work is needed to consider how these proposals could be applied, and a number of operational challenges will need to be addressed before any final policy is designed and implemented, but we view them as an important contribution to the debate. Second, in the area of market-based finance, with most new use of LIBOR due to stop by the end of this year, the FPC emphasises that market participants should use the most robust alternative benchmarks available in transitioning away from the use of LIBOR to minimise future risks to financial stability. Third, the increasing reliance on a small number of cloud service providers and other critical third parties could increase financial stability risks without greater direct oversight of the resilience of the services they provide. Although the PRA and FCA have recently strengthened the regulation of firms' operational resilience and third-party risk management, additional policy measures to mitigate financial stability risks in this area are needed. And the FPC welcomes the bank, FCA, and Treasury engagement on how to tackle these risks. Let me finish by reiterating that the FPC aims to ensure the UK financial system is prepared for and resilient to the wide range of risks it could face. As I've outlined and covered in the financial stability report, the UK banking system is strong enough to provide the support households and businesses need as the economy recovers. We're also working to strengthen financial markets so they can support the economy in bad times as well as good. Thank you. And we'll now be happy to take questions.
Thanks, Andrew. We'll turn to questions now. In the usual way, please raise your hands through the software and I'll call on you in turn. And also just a reminder to please stick to one question each for now. And with that, I'll turn to Ed Conway at Sky.
Thanks, Seb. Governor, I just remember one of the things you talked about early on in the pandemic is the risk that the banks might not play their part lending out into the wider economy to support the recovery. I just wonder, in hindsight, did that come to pass or not? And do you think in hindsight that as such, those guardrails on dividends were necessary, or was that overkill?
Well, I'll start. I think Sam will want to come in. I mean, you're absolutely right to recall that, Ed, because, of course, a year ago we were in an unprecedented situation. I think it's very important not to apply a judgment of hindsight to the step we took on dividends last year. So my view very much is that it remains the case that that was a very appropriate step to take in the situation we faced. Now, banks did respond in terms of lending. The flow of credit was substantial last year, and, of course, it was necessarily so. That was a mixture of banks' own lending and lending guaranteed by the government. And that was appropriate because there was a mixture of needs there. So I must say my judgment is that the policy framework was entirely appropriate. And you know, we mustn't forget the emergency situation and situation we were in a year ago. Sam, do you want to elaborate?
Yes, thanks. Thanks, Andrew. And morning, Ed. Yeah, I think the decision we took back in March of last year was entirely appropriate. Remember, at that time, all we knew was that the economy was about to suffer the worst downturn we'd experienced in hundreds of years. I think it would have been totally inappropriate to let £7 billion in capital walk out of the banking system with that knowledge and really nothing much else at that point. But we've always been clear that we wanted to come back to our normal approach to capital setting and dividends. And we described in December the guardrails we put in place as temporary and as a stepping stone back to normality, and said we'd come out again now in July, informed by the stress test. So where we find ourselves today is we pay particular attention to three things. First is bank capital positions today and their expected outlook. Now, bank capital positions today are as high as they've ever been, partly due to various things that we've put in place, but also due largely to the way that the government support has shielded the system from some of the pain which it might otherwise have taken. We think that there will be some headwinds as those government support programs roll off over the next period, but they're completely manageable. We've also, of course, had a close look at the interim results from our stress test, and those do show clearly that the banking system could keep lending to the economy through a downturn much worse than what we're expecting to occur. And then also developments in the economy, which has bounced back pretty well, and on our central expectations, yeah, will continue to function well, particularly in a way that matters to banks, which is, you know, unemployment staying low and house prices remaining in a reasonable place. So you put that all together, and I think it's a fairly easy decision. Again, rather like that first decision, it was clear, I think, that we should stop dividends going out, that as of now, we don't have that same case, and therefore we should do what we said and take the guardrails off with immediate effect, which is what we're doing.
It's worth adding that one of the measures that we always allow in the so-called management response to the stress test findings is where the bank has this policy in place is to reduce dividends. In other words, you know, when we do the initial run of any stress test, we allow the bank to say what measures it could plausibly take to offset the effect of the stress test. And where a bank has a dividend, a flexible dividend policy in place, as they should, by the way, then we allow that. So in many ways, what we did last year was to essentially say we want that policy in place up front.
Thanks, Andrew. Faisal at the BBC.
Thanks, Seb. Governor, can I just ask, it seems the general message of the report is despite some fairly extraordinary numbers, house price growth and the like, it's sort of playing down that there's any financial systemic risk from those developments, even given that we're having this runoff of the support given by government to the household and financial sector.
Well, I'll bring John in. Let me just reemphasize what I did say in my opening remarks, that we do expect and are prepared for and want the financial system to be prepared for the fact that households and businesses will need further support from the financial system as the recovery continues. I also highlighted, and it's an important point, that of course the distribution of indebtedness effects, particularly in the corporate sector, is uneven. I made a particular point about SMEs, particular points about, as we know from almost daily news coverage, that obviously COVID has had an uneven effect on different sectors of the economy. So it's important that support remains in place. John, do you want to?
Yeah, I don't know if I was, part of your question was also about the housing market. I think the point I made there is we've seen very strong growth in house prices and transactions over the last 9 months or so. That's being driven clearly in part by government support, and that government support is being tapered out. But it's also possible, we've seen this in other countries as well, that there are structural factors that are driving the housing market, and we're keeping a very close eye on the extent to which a more active housing market with fast rising prices translates into household indebtedness, which is the thing we're worried about, and aggregate vulnerability in the economy. But that hasn't happened so far. But as the governor said in his introductory remarks, That's why the FPC's housing tools are there, to guard against a housing boom turning into a big increase in indebtedness, which leaves us all more vulnerable, and there's a financial stability risk there. So we're by no means complacent about that, but there are temporary factors as well, and we just need to see how the market plays out as the support is withdrawn.
Thanks, John. Catherine at the Times.
Hi all. I just wonder. Hi, you're giving bank boards back the freedom to determine their own dividends. Do you think that they should also be able to determine their own pay structures? Should the UK revisit the bonus cap? Thanks.
Well, we've obviously got quite an elaborate set of remuneration rules in place, some of which come from Europe and some of which actually are our own domestic rules that we put in place after the financial crisis. We don't have any immediate plans to review those, but I mean, like all our rules, we keep them under sort of scrutiny at all times. Sam, do you want to elaborate on that?
Yeah, just briefly. I mean, we expect bank boards to be appropriately prudent in distributions they make both to their shareholders and to their staff, given the vital role that banks are going to play in supporting the recovery. So that is a message that we're giving to the banks, but we think it's quite important to get back to a more normal setting for these, which, as Andrew says, includes quite a lot of quite strong regulation about deferral and clawback and malus and things of those kinds, but does leave those decisions with the boards of banks.
I think it's interesting, Catherine, if I could just make another observation over the last sort of decade or more. I mean, Sam and I were both involved in the early implementation of particularly, as he said, of the malus and deferral rules. And the banks were quite resistant initially to them. I have to say my general sense over the last decade is that they've sort of come around to the view that actually these tools can be quite helpful to them as part of their own, as Sam rightly says, their own setting of remuneration policies. And it is their own setting of remuneration policies, because it's very important that, you know, they take the responsibility for doing that.
Thanks. Stephen at the FT.
Good morning, everyone. I'm just wondering if you can say a little bit about Brexit. In your December report, obviously the threat of a no deal was flagged up as one of the major things you were looking at. And yet it doesn't really feature in at least the short version of the report today. Kind of where are you thinking about it at the moment? You know, with the, it looks like equivalence has been a goal that's been given up on by the UK government. Where does it sit in terms of the future and your list of risks?
Well, John will come in on this as well. First of all, let me say that obviously the checklist that we'd had in place for quite a while, actually, up until the December report, was the checklist we were using up until the end of the transitional arrangements. And much of that checklist, you know, is no longer applicable, actually, in terms of the world we're now in. But you're right, of course, there are issues that are applicable. And we watch them, you know, carefully, and you'll see that in the record of the FPC, as well as in the FSR. I mean, on equivalence, I think it's fair to say that, you know, nothing really has moved forwards. You know, we believe strongly in open markets, and we believe strongly in robust global international standards. We are a strong upholder of those. By the way, we're currently in a process of periodic review by the IMF under the so-called FSAP process. And, you know, we will obviously look forward to as we always do, take very seriously any findings the IMF come up with, because that's the most robust independent assessment that we have. We're ready to have any discussions that the EU would like to have, but at the moment I have to say, you know, there is nothing happening on that front that I'm aware of. Now, I think John will probably want to come on to some of the issues, because we know, and clearing is the obvious example, that there are some deadlines baked in there.
Thanks, Andrew. So, first of all, just to reiterate the point, we had a list of things that had to be done before and had to be managed before the UK left the EU and had to be managed before the UK's trade and cooperation agreement with the UK were finalised. And that's what the checklist was about. And now it's much more a question of the FPC monitoring risks that may come from the relationship that evolves. And specific risks like clearing, which I'll come on to. And maybe just also to emphasise that point that we're committed to outcomes-based equivalents, and those are the arrangements we have with many countries, but bluntly, both sides need to want that for that relationship to exist. On the clearing side, there is a temporary permission for EU firms to use UK clearinghouses, which expires in about a year's time. It's clearly a decision for the EU whether it wants its firms to be allowed to use UK clearinghouses or not, and that that's their decision for them to take. I think the important thing for the bank and for the FPC is that whatever their decision, it's done in an ordered way, and that we manage the consequence of it without any risk to financial stability. So, as I say, we're very prepared for an open relationship based on outcomes-based equivalents, but the EU will have to take its own decision for its own reasons on what it wants to do about clearing. What we can't do, though, is have that decision lead to disorder and stress in clearing markets, bearing in mind, of course, that UK clearinghouses are used by firms in jurisdictions all over the world, and we have a responsibility for the stability of clearing in the UK internationally. I'll stop there. Thanks, then.
Thank you.
Thanks, John. Lucy at the Mail.
Morning, all. Just a quick one on the warning that you've given about cloud service providers. Can you give a bit more information on, you know, sort of what some of the services are that these providers give that you deem to be sort of most integral, and what kind of further monitoring you'd like to see?
Yeah, I think Sam or John will want to come in on this. Let me just start. I mean, the background to this is that cloud service providers are an increasingly integral part of the infrastructure of financial system. By the way, of course, they're also integral in quite a few other parts of the world of life as well. But you know, in our world, they're an increasingly integral. There's many good reasons for that. I mean, it is a model that works in that sense. But as they become more integral, obviously the risks to the system increase, systemic risks increase, and it becomes much more of a matter of focus. One point I would highlight before I hand over is that, you know, the model has been developed in quite an opaque and closed fashion. Now, I understand part of the reason for that, because obviously, you know, we don't want people publishing how this thing works in great detail so that attackers get the guidebook, as it were. So, you know, we have to balance that. But as regulators and as people concerned with financial stability, as they become more integral to the system, we have to get more assurance that they are meeting the levels of resilience that we need.
Sam? Maybe I could add a little bit. Thanks, Andrew. Morning, Lucy. Directly to your question, this is no longer a question of peripheral banking systems being outsourced to the cloud. We are now seeing very important systems and data being outsourced in that way. Now, that can bring benefits, yeah, both of efficiency, which is often the driver, also sometimes of resilience, for instance, to cyber attack. But there are obvious risks to that, as with any outsourcing arrangement. And we've got to be confident that our statutory objectives are appropriately reflected in the way that that's done. Now, we have got some tools already. So we've got this operational resilience policy that Andrew referred to in his opening remarks, which basically says, here's a standard that you as a bank or an insurance company have to meet, regardless of how your plumbing works, whether it's outsourced or not. We have outsourcing requirements as well. We have Section 166 reports that we use. But it seems that, you know, across all of that, given this is becoming more and important, we probably will need to do more. And I finish on this point. This is also an international debate. So you can see the EU has already brought in something called DORA. But there's no established model yet internationally. And we are very strongly engaged, indeed leading some work in the FSB and in other places to agree how this is going to work. Thanks.
Thanks, Sam. Russell at the Telegraph.
Morning, Andrew.
Morning, Russell.
Your comments on global asset prices and underwriting standards slipping. How great a risk is there? Are we seeing a global bubble inflating at the moment?
Well, it's certainly a risk that we're watching very carefully. I mean, I would say that the story on asset prices is, you know, it varies from one part of the landscape to the next. So it's not true that, you know, all asset prices are highly elevated. And by the way, it's by no means true that all asset prices are highly elevated relative to what we might call the sort of the underlying determinants of asset prices. That's not true either. But we have seen, obviously, a number of a number of what you might call isolated incidents in recent months, which, you know, obviously we are concerned to ensure we understand the nature of them. In and of themselves, they haven't been systemic. So it's a landscape we watch very carefully. You know, I'm sure John will come in a moment. I did in my remarks, and we do highlight, for instance, underwriting standards in leverage loans, which have moved undoubtedly. And of course, in many ways, it's the final point I'll make. It's been an interesting story in the last year or so because, you know, of course, it wouldn't have been out of the question based on previous sort of experience that the sort of shock that we've had in the last year caused by COVID would have led to an excessive tightening of standards, which would have caused us the other problem, which is, you know, lack of credit supply and fragility in the economy. So we've avoided that, but we have to watch out for the other risk. John, do you want to?
Yeah, thanks, Andrew. So look, we've as Andrew says, it's a mixed picture, and it's different among between different asset classes and between different jurisdictions. There's some variation as well. But when you look at things like high yield debt, you've seen the compression in spreads, you know, has taken us there down to levels close to pre-financial crisis, and leverage loans. There are a number of areas. I've also seen that to some extent the terms becoming less prudent. So you see that in leverage lending. You see that, I think, to some extent in the popularity of some of the SPAC mechanisms. So there are things to watch there. And this is an unusual conjuncture because on the one hand, we've just been talking about risk the economy, risk the households, risk the corporates as we come out of the pandemic. And on the other hand, we see possibly evidence of elevated risk taking in other areas. So it's a bit of a mixed picture. Some of what's happening in financial markets is to do with the improvement in economic news, vaccination, and you'd expect that. But I think we're going through a period in which there could be a correction simply because, you know, the exit from the pandemic might not be what people are expecting. And then some of the dynamics we saw last March, which led to a repricing of assets, then driving a much stronger dash for cash. Some of those dynamics, those vulnerabilities are still there. International community is working on correcting them, but they're still there. And I think that's the point we're trying to make in the FSR.
Thanks, John. Silva at Bloomberg.
Yes, thanks. On dividends and payouts again, a member of the European Central Bank yesterday said that the ECB will call on lenders to be cautious when they consider payouts, and indicated that there would be sort of tight scrutiny when any curbs are lifted. Why is the Bank of England sort of more eager to throw off the guardrails at this moment? What explains the difference? And do you worry about any sort of surge in payouts by UK banks? Thanks.
Well, I'm sure someone wants to come in. I mean, I would say this. I obviously, we're not privy to the thinking in the ECB, so I can't possibly comment on that. What I would say is that we have a framework in place, that, you know, we had a framework in place, and we're going back to that. So this is not a free-for-all at this point by any means. Sam, do you want to?
Yeah, I would just add, obviously, we're liaising very closely with the team in the SSM. The ECB on statements. I mean, you can look at the last line of our statement today, which just says exactly what you said. So I think we're saying pretty much the same. And yeah, I think we would expect banks to be appropriately prudent in what level of dividends they pay out, given the role that the banks will play in supporting the economy going forward. And I think that'll be the case. I mean, if you look at what banks accrued, so we've been allowing banks to accrue during the first half of the year, but not pay out. You look at what they accrued in the first quarter, there's 10 basis points across the system, you know, from a starting point of 16.2. So, you know, I don't think that we need to be concerned about this, but obviously it's something that we'll keep an eye on. But at the same time, I don't want to create any lack of clarity. I don't want to take off the guardrails, but the guardrails are somehow still there. We're taking them off. It's back with bank boards, and we'll expect them to take sensible decisions.
I mean, you know, just to be clear, we've been content with how dividend policy has operated in the sort of the period up to COVID. And you have to put that into the context of the capital framework. You have to put it into context of the stress tests. There's plenty of tools there to, in a sense, enable banks to take these decisions, and those tools will continue to apply.
Thanks very much. Hugh at Reuters.
Hello.
Morning, Hugh.
Yeah. Good morning. It's with the crypto, really, I'm interested in. I think the bank still thinks that, it's not a systemic risk to take action. But you say there's a growing interest among big investors, institutional investors, and this could cause interlinkages with systemic markets. I mean, why wouldn't you take action now to really safeguard that these interlinkages don't threaten financial stability? And are you asking crypto exchanges, institutional investors, banks to introduce additional safeguards when they deal with crypto?
Well, I've said a lot over the years on crypto, and I haven't changed my view on crypto, which is often viewed as quite severe. But I hold it that any investors have to be very clear that you could lose all your money unless it has no intrinsic value. I think, our view at the moment is that from a sort of institutional point of view, the evidence does not point to it being a large part of the picture. But we clearly have to watch it very carefully, as we do, because it is a fast-changing landscape. John, did you want to?
Yeah, I'd just say the Basel Committee has put out some proposals about how crypto should be valued on banks' balance sheets. And of course, different crypto assets have different characteristics. But I think that's quite a prudent approach that's been suggested in terms of the capital banks have to hold. And we're watching quite carefully where something which is at the moment primarily retail and speculative, and it's highly speculative. I think there is action that needs to be taken to ensure that retail investors understand the risks they're taking. But from a financial stability point of view, the point at which you act is the point where you think that actually you have a risk that is beginning to crystallize. And at the moment, we're not at that point. But we can see the way this might happen. And I think there's thinking going on in lots of areas about what one would do to prevent that. But at the moment, as Andrew says, it's not. It's mainly in the retail space.
Holly at PA.
Yes, good morning all. Just on the point about companies' default rates looking like they're going to rise in certain sectors and concerns over the debt levels. Just wondering how confident you are that banks will be supportive to small firms as these emergency loans become due and as the support schemes are coming to an end.
Well, let me start. I think two things. One, our assessment that we've published today reinforces the view that banks' own financial positions are robust and strong enough that they can provide that support. And by the way, it's in the interests of banks to provide that support because they will get better results and they will find their own financial performance is stronger if, of course, we act decisively to prevent an exaggeration of the cycle and a disruption of the recovery by financial concerns. So that's important. Second thing I'd emphasize is a point that we've made repeatedly but make again is that underlying that assessment of banks' positions is the view that therefore, if they need to, banks can use the buffers of capital that they have built up and that we expect them to have, to provide just the sort of support you're talking about. And that is important. And it's important that banks have the confidence and understand that that's what they can do. This is what the system enables. It's part of the countercyclical nature of the system that we've created post-financial crisis. And they should use it if they need to. I don't know if Sam or John want to come in.
I just have very very briefly, just on the, particularly on the schemes, Holly. So I think the banks did a good job of getting, you know, the £75 billion or so of government guaranteed lending out to firms of all different sizes in the last period. We're coming into a different phase now where we've got the recovery loan scheme, and the take-up of that has been quite low so far. I don't think that's at all surprising, given what firms have already drawn down and the less appealing terms of those loans. The pay-as-you-go option on the bounce-back loans is also getting quite considerable take-up. But the key will be, and we don't really have much from this yet, is as repayments become due, how do the loans perform? And I just would say that the very early data on that is probably a little bit more positive than some of the very high default rates, which were being talked about last year. But it's early days still. I see. I think John wanted to come in too.
No, it's fine. I think you covered the pay-as-you-grow point.
Thanks. Oscar at Yahoo.
Morning, guys. Sorry, just unmuting myself there. I'm just wondering, obviously, there's been a lot of discussion recently about these record levels of private equity activity in the UK so far this year. Obviously, traditionally, that comes with an increased level of indebtedness for the corporations that are targeted. And there's been some fears in the press about what it could mean for jobs, for big employers, if the sort of risks there go wrong. Was there any discussion within the FPC about the increase in private equity activity? And if so, what was the sort of committee's view on this?
Well, let me start. I think it's fair to say we don't take a particular view on private equity in and of itself, so not per se. What I would say, though, is I think COVID has, you know, I hope and think that COVID has illustrated this forcefully, is really about the question of corporate leverage. So what COVID has illustrated, I think, is that companies that increase their leverage beyond levels that are safe and sustainable are, of course, in a much less resilient position when a shock comes along, and we've had a very big one. And so I think the very clear message should be to companies, you know, leverage matters. It matters, you know, because, you know, it matters to from the point of view of the resilience of your own financial position, and therefore you need to, you know, you need to have regard to it. Now, that's not a point, you know, as I say, per se about private equity. It's a point about leverage. You know, if you are a highly leveraged company, you are going to be more exposed to the sorts of shocks that I'm afraid can happen.
Thanks, Kevin.
Mate at Pliske.
Thank you. I wanted to go back to the subject of the cloud, and I seem to remember that a couple of years ago, the Bank of England approached this subject and concluded there wasn't a need for additional measures. So I wonder, is this conclusion today the result of additional digitization from the pandemic and branch closures and stuff like that? Thank you.
I think it's a broader point than that. But Sam, do you want to come in?
Yeah, Mate, you're right that our position has moved on a bit, but the reason for that is a very simple one, which is just that we've crossed a further threshold in terms of what sort of systems and what volume of systems and data are being outsourced to the cloud. So as you would expect, we track that quite closely. It's carried on in the same direction. It has, by the way, accelerated a bit during the last year and a half, but I'm not convinced that's because of COVID or because of remote working. I think probably that would have happened anyway. Thanks.
Yeah, I might hand it. I might just say this is not just a UK phenomenon. This is happening in advanced economies, actually emerging markets as well, for banking systems, because there are advantages in using the cloud, both in terms of cost and possibly in terms of resilience. So as Sam said earlier, I mean, in the end, I think the answer to this issue of how you deal with a kind of new global service, a cross-border service, is going to be around international standards and getting international agreement about how to manage these risks in the same way as we manage other risks from in the financial sector, from cross-border services. But this is, I think, not a UK thing. It's happening more generally. Thanks.
I would also just, Mate, just reinforce a point I made earlier. I think it's important. We don't want to give the message here that we think the cloud is somehow sort of structurally unsound. It isn't. I mean, you know, it's important to remember, and I can speak with experience from this in terms of organizations that I've been responsible for in recent years. You know, in the old fashioned world of having data centers, things can happen. I can tell you from experience. So, you know, in many ways, of course, the cloud is a, you know, is a robust infrastructure in that sense, because it's, you know, it's being managed to high standards of resilience. The point we're making, and Sam and John have just reinforced, is that as it becomes more concentrated, as usage of it becomes more concentrated, obviously its systemic importance increases.
Thanks, Andrew. Arida at Financial World.
Hi, good morning. I was struck by what Mr. Cunliffe said about increased indebtedness. Could you talk a little bit about regulating buy now, pay later lenders? Is that something you discussed and something you can comment on?
I think that's really a matter for the FCA. You know, obviously there was the report undertaken by Chris Woolard on that area, which is published. It's not something that the FPC regards as a systemic issue. So, you know, any questions on that really are very much for the FCA.
Thanks, Andrew. Kalina at The Guardian.
Hi, good morning. Again, on the cloud, I mean, you said concerns about concentration. Is that about concentration amongst providers? Because as you'll know, a lot of organizations, not just banks, obviously rely on, say, Amazon Web Services. Are there concerns about making sure that the banking system is diversifying its providers?
Sam, do you want to comment on that?
Kalina, yeah, that part of the concern is about the concentration of supply, but there's also a separate, though related, concern just about the amount of this stuff that is moving into cloud service providers, whether or not they're concentrated, and they're two distinct points. In some ways, you know, the concentration is a worrying thing. In other ways, you know, it may make some of this more tractable, because actually you only need to have a direct engagement with a relatively small number of suppliers in order to get what you need.
Thanks, Sam. And I think last question is just a follow-up from Russell at The Telegraph.
Back on the cloud again. On the concentration point, and the volumes, could you give me some more color and figures or data, if you have any, on the sort of the acceleration of services which have been placed onto the cloud, which is sort of beginning to raise flags at the bank?
Sam, do you have any ready facts we can?
Yeah, I don't want to give you figures, Russell, but to give you some color, this is no longer, as it was a few years ago, something happening, if you like, around the periphery of bank systems. So, yeah, systems that might be very important, but wouldn't obviously go directly to financial stability. You might think of it, you know, sort of a less important HR system, for instance, versus a core ledger. Whereas what we now have moving are things that are much more integral to the running of banks and those core systems, which could go to safety and soundness. And as Andrew is saying, it is not our view that that is a bad thing. It may indeed be a good thing from various perspectives, but we just need to make sure that as it's done, our statutory objectives are being reflected. And while we have some tools, we've got to the point of thinking that we may need some more.
Can I just add? Oh, John, do you want to? Sorry, John.
No, just to add, it's not just about banks. We're also seeing financial market infrastructure firms also turn into the cloud for the same reasons of efficiency and resilience, and other market participants, banks and others, connecting to central infrastructure or wanting to connect to central infrastructure through the cloud. So it's just becoming important now in systemic interconnections as well as in firms' core activities.
I just wanted to add that one of the things, of course, and we know this from the economics of all of this, the microeconomics of all of this, but it's relevant to the point about concentration, is that as, of course, the market becomes more concentrated on one supplier or a very small number of suppliers, those suppliers can exercise market power in terms not only of the price, but also the terms. And that is where we do have a concern and do have to look carefully, because, you know, that concentrated power on terms can manifest itself in the form of, you know, secrecy, opacity, you know, not providing customers with, you know, with the sort of information they need to be able to monitor the risk in the service. And we have seen some of that going on, I would say. We've seen some of that developing. And I think, you know, that what we're going to need to see in place in terms of the standards of resilience and the testing around some of the standards of those resilience, frankly, we'll have to roll some of that back. That secrecy that goes with it, it's not consistent with our objectives.
Okay, I've got two late questions in, but then we'll close it. One follow-up from Wida at Financial World.
Hi, could I just ask you very quickly about your access to bank data? Does the cloud help you get a better overview of what is going on within banks? And does that mean that you could extend what you do in the regulatory space toward the cloud providers to get that increased transparency? Or is that a step too far?
I think there is a link there. It's interesting you point to that, because I think that in my experience, when firms transfer their operations and systems to the cloud, it isn't just a matter of sort of saying, here's a load of kit, please take it over. Quite often, you know, firms are rebuilding their systems as part of that transformation. And that therefore can yield benefits, I think, both for the firm and for the regulators, in terms of ease of access to data, ease of manipulation of data. Because, you know, one of the other big things we're all going through, I mean, we're in this world as well, is obviously we're all working to change and improve and radically change the way in which we handle data and the tools that we use. And so those things can go together, yeah. And that, of course, is a benefit.
Thanks, Andrew. And lastly, Catherine at The Times.
Hi. So Andrew, just on this secrecy point, is the idea that whichever firm we might be talking about, Amazon Web Services or whoever, that they are being reasonably secretive and that's their kind of modus operandi? Or is it the kind of relationship between them and the bank? And as I think you said earlier, just not the desire not to kind of advertise how these things work because that's risky. And then are you just straightforwardly saying that what might happen is that those firms, rather than kind of going through the operational risk work you've already done, where you expect the regulated firms to kind of manage that risk, that you might directly take, you know, they might come within the kind of regulatory world?
Well, we haven't got to that point. What I would say is that I think, let me say two things on this. Take your first point. I think we have to strike a careful balance here, going back to what I was saying earlier, between, you know, enough openness that both the users and the regulators can understand the risks and resilience of the system and that it meets, you know, meets our standards. Obviously, you don't want the sort of openness which opens you up to the risk, particularly, you know, let's be honestly, particularly cyber risk. So there is obviously a, you know, careful balance. And I do understand the point that cloud service providers make, that, you know, they do not want to obviously have openness, which opens, sorry to use the word twice, opens it up to that sort of risk. And that's a very valid point. So we've got to strike a balance here. The second thing I'd say is, I mean, we have had obviously quite a bit of experience now going back to cyber for a moment in terms of requiring particularly major banks to undertake resilience testing. And to undertake external resilience testing through the program that we've had in place, so the CBES program. Now, you know, it's not a direct read across to the world of cloud, but you know, I think some of those tools that we've developed, you know, in the work that we've done on operational risk, are the sorts of tools that, you know, I think our thinking will sort of crystallize, I think, around, you know, how can we take that sort of approach and apply it into this world.
Thanks so much, Andrew. And with that, thanks to everyone for joining us today, and take care and speak soon.
Thank you. Bye.